As energy storage technology progresses, it will offer a range of solutions and services to the users of the electricity industry. A new study, just detailed in Nature Energy, explores whether or not this will eventually lead to self-sufficient customers and whether it will spell the end of networks as we know them. Much hope is vested in electricity storage as a game changer in efforts towards decarbonising the energy sector. The idea of storing electricity for use at a later time and even place dates back to the inception of the electricity sector. Of course, hydropower and pumped storage were used early on, and in 1907, battery-driven electric buses were briefly operating on the streets of London. In most industries, storage and conservation of goods smoothens production to match demand with supply. The conventional wisdom has been that electricity is special because demand and supply must match in real time, making the operation of the system and the market considerably more complex. It then followed that if we could store electricity, the electricity market could behave more like normal markets. Electricity storage can of course be viewed in terms of its location in the system, the types of services it must provide, and the timescale of these services. Storage facilities can be placed at all levels of the system, distribution, transmission, generation, and of course the consumer sites. They also provide balancing services that range from a fraction of a second to seasonal. Recently, consumer storage has become part of the concept of consumer generation for self-consumption and even for energy self-sufficiency. While this notion holds some promise, it raises important questions about the future of the electricity sector and, in particular, that of distribution networks. A recent study by Richard Green and Ian Staffel of Imperial College London, writing in Economics of Energy and Environmental Policy, examines the viability of the emerging concept of prosumerage, that of course being the generation of electricity for self-consumption by households, using solar voltaic cells combined with storage devices. The storage component of prosumerage retains the excess supply of electricity from intermittent solar power for later use when supply is lower than demand. The aim is to maximise the self-sufficiency of the individual consumer and even gain some full independence from the grid. Green and Staffel's study is framed in the context of the British electricity system and simulates the consumer patterns of three types of representative households, with the sizes of the solar panels scaled to meet each consumer's need and complemented by Tesla's larger Powerwall 2, a 13.5 kWh storage device. The simulations show that consumers with electric heating have most to gain from storage, followed by those with electric vehicles, and finally those that have neither electric heating nor electric vehicles. However, the researchers also show that savings on electricity bills do not offset the purchase and installation costs of the batteries, making the technology uneconomic for the mainstream. Green and Staffel then discuss that prosumerage would also be uneconomical in Germany and even Spain, where the solar resource base is far more favourable than in Britain. Furthermore, by extending the model to explore the aggregate effects of prosumerage with solar and wind power on net system load, they find that the selfishness or uncoordinated prosumerage of individual households will not result in significant system benefits, although it slightly flattens the load duration curve. Despite the lack of a clear economic case for consumer-scale storage, some users will adopt this option and leave the grid for a variety of motives. The key issue, however, is the scale of storage solutions. The discussion of consumer-scale versus grid-scale storage is important because it ultimately can decide the future shape of the grid, or of course whether it has a future. Grid-scale storage can provide different technical and economic benefits due in part to its potential for system-wide services that it may provide, although this requires substantial cost reductions and newer business models. Indeed, each type of storage service may require its own storage technology, and grid storage can then facilitate more efficient use both of renewable and conventional generation capacity. There is therefore a need for policy debate and research, as the outcome of this transition process should not be left to chance, markets or technology. Regulators and policymakers need to protect the network benefits of the grid arising from the aggregation of diverse sources of generation and demand. Cost reductions in grid-scale storage could make it a distribution network resource, but it will also challenge the business models of the established utilities. Further innovations can further increase the network benefits of grid-scale storage through smart technologies, market design, and renewable support policies. Additionally, electric storage should not be viewed in isolation from the energy and infrastructure services. The emerging paradigm of energy systems integration explores the efficiency gains from integrating different energy vectors, for example electricity, gas and heat, with other network industries. Storage can then provide even more useful and feasible features on the network of networks context. Without a doubt, energy storage has a great role to play in the facilitation and the integration of renewable energy onto the grid and brings with it a host of benefits. Creating the market conditions that are conducive to energy storage becoming financially viable is a challenge of global significance. This challenge will take time to get right, but since ultimately electricity sectors that make full use of the potential of storage should be cheaper, more secure, and more environmentally sustainable, this surely is a goal worth pursuing.